Hi, this is Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com, and today we are going to tackle a problem we have with rabbits. We're calling this Rabbit Roundup.
Rabbit.
And what we're going to do is discuss different ways that we can keep them under control, because there's no way you can get rid of all the rabbits that perhaps are inhabiting your yard, and not that we would want to. But we wanted to let you know that there are ways that can be used. Wisconsin has three different kinds of rabbits. Now, the ones we usually see are the Peter rabbit kind, the cottontail with the white tail and the brown, grayish-brown body.
Like a Playboy bunny?
No.
Oh.
Then there is the snowshoe rabbit, which I didn't know we had snowshoe rabbits in Wisconsin. They're the ones that turn white in the winter. Excuse me. They're brownish-gray in the summer, but they turn white in the winter. And then, for some reason, somebody thought it would be a good idea to introduce jackrabbits into Wisconsin. And they did that in the mid-70s.
Yeah, but we have snow bunnies.
Wrong species.
Oh.
So there are three different kinds. We, of course, seem to have only the cottontail rabbits here. And they are abundant. Their natural enemies are fox, weasels, coyotes, and cats. Now, there happens to be a feral cat in our neighborhood, and every now and again we'll see it. I have no idea if it attacks rabbits or not, but it's about the same size as a rabbit. Why don't we want rabbits in our yard? They eat vegetables. They like to chew on anything that you like in your garden to eat yourself, probably they will eat. They don't particularly like squash or tomatoes, but if they were desperate, they would eat them. But they do also chew on your woody bushes and trees. They girdle trees, fruit trees. The smoother the bark, the more they like it.
Well, what were those bushes that we bought that time that they just loved?
Burning bushes.
Oh, my goodness.
We're going to take a look at those,
yeah.
Because every year they have never gotten... Our burning bushes never get past 2 feet, because 1 foot is always chewed off in the winter. Rabbits can have 6 litters in one season, starting in April in Wisconsin. And each litter has about 6 rabbits. So that is 36 rabbits from just one female rabbit. So you know, if you have more than that in your yard, and we have more than that, you're in big trouble. We can go out after it has snowed, and it looks like there's been a rabbit hop all over our yard. There is not one part of our yard that doesn't have rabbit tracks in it. And the dogs go crazy, and yet in the daytime we don't see them. So they come out at night when we're not watching, and we need to do something about them this year. And that's another thing we learned when we were studying about rabbits, is the best way to control them, the best time to control them, is in the winter. They only live about a year, no longer than 3 years, but if you can control them in the winter, they'll be less to populate your garden in the summertime. Another way to control them is try to use things, plants that rabbits don't like to eat, but again, if it's hard times out there and they can't find something, they will eat whatever is available. And another way is to eliminate their hiding places. And we are guilty of that, because we have a row of compost, bigger compost that we don't use in the garden. It's just a place that we carry it over to the edge of the lot, and we've kind of made a row, and it's a great hiding place. And last but not least is trapping, which is probably the best way to eliminate some of the rabbits. We're going to talk about that also. And another way to help control rabbits and deer, perhaps at the same time, is to use a product that they don't like. And because of its smell, Liquid Fence has been quite effective if you can get it on often enough during the season. It's made of putrefied eggs.
I can testify to that.
It makes it horrible. And garlic and a soapy base. And It's good for use on edible crops, so you could use it in your garden during the summer or spring. It's terribly smelly, but once you have it sprayed on and it dries, it's not smelly to humans, only to the rabbits.
Well, they don't like the way it tastes.
Or smells. Yeah. It's right. I think it's, well, probably both. Our burning bushes have been sprayed with this, but unfortunately, you know, once they get buried in the snow, there's nothing more you can do about it. So at this point, before we have any layers of snow, which will be today because next week they're talking snow, it's a great time to put either the initial layer on or a new one. I've used this product for years. I get mad at it every year because I go to mix up a batch and I start spraying and my sprayer clogs, and finally the light came on. And what I do now is I strain it as I pour it into a measuring cup. Because it doesn't have any poison in it, I can still use my little strainer for food once I've washed it really well. And you mix it up 1 cup to a gallon. This is a quart, so I've only put 1/4 cup in here. And as I use it, I'm going to shake it some more.
And the reason you use the strainer is what? Just to get the
right.
larger granules
yes.
out?
Yes, well, it's a sediment that forms in the bottom after you haven't used it. So you shake it up really well. Make sure the cover is on really tight. Usually I don't do this in my kitchen. I don't do it in the house at all because it's so smelly. But because it's cold outside, I'm going to do it. So you just shake it up. You can see there's a little thing that tells how much you have.
Kind of a clear guide on the side. Yeah.
And you pour it through the strainer, obviously, into your measuring cup, and then you dump it in there. So onward to the outside we go. It's about 35 degrees out, but it's kind of damp and a little bit windy, so it feels cold. These are our burning bushes. This is typical rabbit destruction. If it were a deer, it would be all raggedy on the top where the bite is, but since it's chewed off at nice sharp angles, we know that that is rabbits. And this bush this year probably grew twice this size. It was doing so well. We thought, oh, maybe this will be it, because once they do get to a certain point, the rabbits don't seem to bother it anymore. But we have one here, there, there, and there, and they've chewed them all off.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Now you see we have protected our peach tree by putting in this wire fence. We learned from last year that it can't be just that tall. It has to be much higher, and I've protected the branches from the wire by wrapping old socks around them to keep it from rubbing. Now a deer could come along and chew on this, of course, but I mean there's only so much you can do. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually spray the bush itself. I'll try not to spray you.
Oh, thank you.
You're welcome. And then you want to spray about 1 foot away, and then even a little bit more. My other help, I was hoping it was going to help, is I actually put our dog waste here around this bush in hopes that the smell of it would have an effect, but I think I did it too late. You should probably do this, if you can do it, every couple of weeks. Be perfect. If you can't, you know, do it when the weather is cooperating. But
I also notice you're wearing rubber gloves and you put the cuffs inside out so it doesn't dribble up down your sleeve.
It is some stinky stuff. Okay, so I'll do that to all of these bushes and soak them down well, and then around. Gives them a little perimeter, like, uh-oh, get me away from that.
I mean, look at that. They've chewed every single one.
Yep.
I like this mushroom cluster here. That's rather cool.
Isn't it neat?
Beautiful. Wow.
That was a...
Old tree stump, right?
Yeah.
Yep.
But you can see, here's evidence that it is a rabbit, because there's the rabbit poo.
Yep.
There's my dog poo, which
didn't,
I guess,
make a difference.
No. I'm putting a nice perimeter around it. This one I tried hiding, but that didn't help.
I mean, you hate to put wire cages around every single plant you have. Gets to be kind of ridiculous after a while.
Right, and you know, you don't mind sharing your yard with some things, but when they are so destructive, it's sad. It's truly sad. I thought we had another one. Oh, yep, here it is.
Yeah, they've been here too.
And it's good and smelly. That's what we like. They even chewed on your, looks like your maple.
Yeah.
Is that a Japanese maple in there?
Yep.
There you go. Okay, but let's go look. Oh yeah, here's another one.
Actually, this one they didn't get to, because look, there's buds on it.
Right, well, this one's getting bigger. See, it's getting a little taller and a little bigger. So this will help protect it even more. I think this is one more. Put a perimeter around it. Why are you moving away?
It smells. I didn't say you smell. I said it smells.
Okay, let's go see their hiding place. Now this could be a hiding place right here in this boxwood, but you know, there's no way we're gonna kick it down our boxwood. But there is place in the back where you'll see that they are very happy.
Let's go check it out.
Another thing you have to watch for is if you're feeding the birds, which we love to do and love to see them all winter, is that that too will attract some pests. And when it gets just even a little warm out, you're going to have voles or even house mice, field mice, that will come and start eating up the seeds that have dropped on the ground. One of the things that we do almost all summer and into the fall is we just put mouse traps outside. And we put it, you know, where the birds aren't going to be caught in it. But it's amazing how many mice and voles you will trap. And that too will cut down the population, because they too will chew on your bushes during the winter time.
Well, I was reading, how many do you have in a square 100-foot area? I mean, it was something like a couple hundred?
Couple hundred voles, yes.
I mean, that's incredible.
And voles, for you that may not know, they're about this big and they're real velvety looking. They can be from a grayish to a dark, dark charcoal gray. They have a very short little tail, and they're rather pretty looking, but they are very ferocious. And you don't want to get near them, because they could bite you just like a mouse. But again, they attack your bushes.
Well, they have a toxin in them too.
Yes, they do have a toxin, and it causes paralysis for a short time wherever they bite you. That's how they get their food. Off we go. We've heard from Rick's sister and brother-in-law in California about the gopher problem that they are having in their yard. I mean, they can watch the gopher cut off a head of lettuce and drag it down into the hole. Now that is really sad. So what we recommended to them, and what we have learned, is that you have to actually dig a hole. If you're not going to fence in a hole area, or even if you are, you need to protect it with a wire cloth. This is called a wire cloth. And what it is very closely spaced, a quarter of an inch square space, that you have to actually bury 1 foot into the ground and 9 inches out, facing outward. So if this were my hole, I'd have to dig this down 1 foot and then have 9 inches sticking outward. And that way they won't be able to burrow into the actual pit that you're trying to protect.
Well, the other thing I recommend it too is that for plants that they really want to protect, not only do they have to do it below ground because of the gophers, but they're also going to have to do it above ground as well and cage it in with wire mesh and not the deer right. netting, the plastic deer netting, because right. they would just chew through that.
Exactly. This is good in the summertime when you're just trying to keep our rabbits that can easily go and eat someplace else. This is just a little discouragement for them. And it protects it from the deer because the deer don't like to bother with it if they can hop away and get something easier.
Well, Dave built a fence around everything, but the gophers are still inside in the hole. So, you know, it's either trap them or you could have spikes that go into the gopher hole. So you do have a lot of options. Right. But again, you do want to check with your state and local
rules.
Regulations
yes.
as to how you can trap or eliminate, eradicate.
Yes.
You know, unwanted pests.
In some areas, if you were out in the country, you could actually shoot at them and kill them that way. And one of the suggestions where I was reading is either to dispose of them, bury them, or eat them. Rabbits, now we're talking about.
Possum pepper.
So they've been doing it for hundreds of years. So of course you could do that.
Yeah, some people raise them.
Mm-hmm. This is the area I was talking about where we've just thrown branches and, you know, trimmings that we've done off of trees. Well, the squirrels, or the, well, possibly squirrels too, and rabbits now have this beautiful little living space right here that spreads all along, I'm sure. So it's a great place to live if you're a rabbit, but we don't want you. One of the traps we have is a large one. We've caught squirrels in here. We haven't ever actually caught a rabbit in this one. But these are the traps that we use most often, especially in the summer. And we catch chipmunks in that one a lot. We've caught squirrels in there and rabbits in that little one. And what do you do with them once you catch them? Well, you can take them to a rural area. And you can let them go as long as you're a couple miles away.
They won't like it.
No, they won't like it. You cannot let them go in parks or near where people live because that just moves your problem to somebody else's problem. And there are state rules about where you can let them go. Mostly what we do is we drown them. And it sounds horrible, but it's very quick and you need to be checking your traps every day, possibly twice a day, because you don't want a rabbit or a squirrel or anything to be caught in a trap and freeze to death. That would be horrible.
Or starve to death.
Yes.
I mean, that's not humane.
Right.
I mean, you know, as terrible as it is, I mean, when we think of the number of chipmunks that were burrowing under our driveway,
yes.
I mean, there were holes all over the place and under our porches. I mean, we're talking not just dozens, we're talking about hundreds.
Yes.
And, you know, when it gets to be that level of a problem, you have to address it. Otherwise, it just gets worse.
Yes. So what I've done is I brought some dried apple to put in the big cage. The little cages, I have just found if I put them in runways where I know that the animals go, they just go in there and catch themselves without even any bait in there.
Yeah.
So I'm going to be putting this, the rabbit trap itself, the big one, in right in front of that door over there.
Well, I notice you put
and I put peanut butter in here as a glue.
Oh, okay.
That's my glue. Now, if you're going to use peanuts or something like that, then you need to anchor that down better than just peanut butter because a squirrel would just go in there and pull it off and not be caught. Okay. There we go. Now this one will just close up when it goes in there and touches the bait. Something else that was recommended is to cover the back of the trap. Just don't interfere with the mechanism, but just to kind of hide it a little bit. One more. There we go. So I'll be checking that regularly, and hopefully it'll help keep the rabbit population down. We'll have less rabbits in the summer and possibly less damage in our garden. So if you have a problem with wildlife in your yard, check with your natural resource people.
Well, your DNR, your local DNR, or even your local universities will have extension programs through the Master Gardening Program and have all the rules, regulations.
Yes. You don't want to be breaking rules, but you don't want them taking over either. So we would like to thank everyone for watching. We have had a wonderful, wonderful year, and we'd like to wish everybody a Merry Christmas, a Happy Hanukkah, and Happy Holidays, and a very, very Happy New Year.
Prosperous and healthy.
Yes. If you like the video, please give us a thumbs up. We'd love to hear what you do in your garden to protect from wildlife. And if you'd like to join our garden family, please subscribe. Bye for now.